As we read God's Word today, picking up what the Holy Spirit lays down, the fruit of the Spirit, Galatians 5. But the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against these things. Let's pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day, for your many blessings, for the wonderful opportunity to be in your house. God, we pray, Lord, that as we thank you so much for the privilege that we've had to worship Jonathan, the band, the special music, Robin. We just thank you, Lord, for these blessings. We ask, Lord, that you just bless our time in Bible study. Speak to us from your word today. May your Holy Spirit convict us and convince us, even as we talk about how he grows fruit in our lives. Bless our time again, for we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You guys can be seated. Well, again, the context for our text is that he's been talking to them about two natures. You have the works of the flesh. You have your flesh, your old nature, your human nature. And you have the Holy Spirit, Jesus, living in you. And there's your two natures. And just like we've said several times, the old-fashioned cartoon with a little angel, a little devil, trying to get you to do different things. That's kind of how your two natures operate. Your old nature, your flesh, is speaking to your heart and your mind and tempting you and trying to get you to do the things that are wrong. The fruits of the Spirit are grown in your life to continue to help you do things that are right. And as you live each day, that battle is going on. And you have to decide, not just daily, but all the time, what nature are you going to listen to? Are you going to listen to your flesh, or are you going to listen to the Holy Spirit who's living within you? We need to be constantly, continuously, intentionally choose the fruits of the Spirit. So today we want to look at some very specific fruit. There were six of them left. We're going to cover a couple of them pretty fast. Kindness is what I would call the golden rule: proactive, do unto others. You know, there were people all over the world and in all different kinds of civilizations, and even before Jesus, who were saying almost the golden rule, but not quite. They were saying this: don't do to others what you don't want people to do to you. There's a big difference in that golden rule. The golden rule is a positive. It is an affirmative. Not only, you know, of course you're not going to do to others what you don't want done to you. Now we're going to turn that around. We're going to do for others what we won't have done in our lives. We want to treat people in every way like we want to be treated. That's kindness. Goodness. I think just our general inclination to think about goodness applies here when people talk about, well, he's a good man. Or he's a good woman, or they're a good person, or that's a good kid. You know, those are the kind of attributes that we're thinking here. Doing the right thing for the right reason. Then the third one that I want to talk about, and we'll spend time on the rest of them, is gentleness. And gentleness is not weakness, it is power, absolutely. It's power. It's power that's under control. How many of y'all have a horse, ride a horse, or anything like that? Have you ever seen a horse on TV or something? Okay, well, good then. A horse is a good illustration, kind of this power under control. This animal, I like what you weighs, 1,500 pounds, something like that. You know, a horse is a big old animal, but it's under control. As people put a bridle in a bit, and you know, the whole horse goes where they want it to go. I haven't had much luck with horses, you know. I'm a little apprehensive about, you know, the interpretations that when we come back to this world after we've gone to heaven, that we're coming on a horse. I'm a little apprehensive about that. I might need to take some riding lessons. My experience with horse riding came when I was 12. The cousins got together. Did you have the cousins in your family? You know, all the cousins. And so I brought about 10 of us, I guess. And I wasn't the oldest cousin, but I was by far the fattest cousin. I mean, you know, we're talking about the days where you had the rolls. You didn't have them, did you? Had the rolls on the neck. You know, so bad in fact that when I was a little boy, I would sweat and beans of dirt would be created between the rolls of fat. And my mama called me a little Stephen Dirt again. So, you know, this situation can get pretty bad, you know. And the other day I told Kalinda, I said, man, I got a white spot on my neck. You know, somehow or another, yeah, it's some kind of, you know, some type of skin situation. You know, when you get older, you just follow me. So, man, trust me on this deal. And so, you know, it's like a spot or something. She said, honey, that's not like an age spot or nothing like that. That's just the sun doesn't get there. Now, when your number two chin is shading your number three chin and keeping it from getting tanned, that's not a good situation. You hear what I'm saying? I mean, that's almost as embarrassing as the tan line. I had a friend, I started to say he lives in the field, but I guess that's irrelevant. Doesn't matter that he lives in the field. And he went to the beach and he had a beer can on his chest and he fell asleep. He had a white circle on his chest where the beer can shaded in shade, you know. I thought that was kind of funny. Anyway, you know, this whole deal, I don't know what I'm telling. I'm looking at the slide, like, where am I? Oh, I'm talking about horses. Okay. So anyway, we all the cousins got together and we were going to ride this horse called a Welsh pony. Anybody know about ponies, Welsh ponies? They're like demonic. They're like so mean. And so this pony, everybody gets out there, and like my five-year-old cousin rides the pony. Yeah, everything's good. My seven or eight-year-old cousin gets out there. Nothing happens. He'll come back, gets off the horse, everything's great. All right, my 12-year-old cousin who's not fat gets on the horse and rides it real fast, man, real good. Everything's going great. So it's my turn. So I get on the horse, and it's like this horse says, not today, student. Taking you nowhere, fat boy. You carry me, how about it? I think that's what that Welsh pony would say. Why don't you carry me? And so anyway, they said, you got to kick it to get it to go. And so I kicked it a little bit, didn't go nowhere. And they said, you got to kick it. So I went, all right then, kaboom, and pachoo, off it took off. About like them horses getting loose on the Kentucky Derby. Except this thing went into an immediate curve and just went around the circle. That curve was no bigger than me, Mark. I'm talking about it was a tiny little curve. And I made about three laps on that little Welsh pony, and about the third lap, I just couldn't hang on no more. And off I went out in the yard. Then they said something that was really stupid. They explained to me that when a horse throws you off, you have to get back on again. And I must have been a stupid kid because I got back on the horse again, and this time it took off through the woods, and I was ducking limbs, and finally I just bailed off. And man, it was bad. And they said I had to get back on again. I said, nah, I don't think so. And I ain't got back on a Welsh pony since. But they say, you know, they say that's power under control. Power under control. Well, let me tell you something. Jesus is the absolute perfect example. He is all power in heaven and earth. And yet he is gentle to everyone, everywhere. It's an amazing thing. John 3:17, John 3:16, right? Listen to the next verse. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Jesus drove the religious leaders of his day nuts because they would want him, you know, they knew that he was going to be gentle. They knew that he was going to forgive people, that he was going to restore people. And that's what you do. That's what gentleness is about. You will have gentleness in your life when your goal is to seek other people's salvation and to seek their restoration. If it's your goal to look down at them, if it's your goal to judge other people, gentleness is not going to thrive much in the orchard that you have. Grace happens here. Well, the second fruit I want to talk to you about is faithfulness. Yep, faithfulness. I call it this hasn't gone over yet, so I'm going to try it a third time. The LIV fruit. You know, an LIV is when something goes dumb and you just go, LIV. So, anyway. You know, it went better that time. It went better. If I had six more times to tell that, it might go right. It's just one of them kind of deals where you thought it said one thing and it said something else. We thought, you know, faithfulness. What is faithfulness? Well, I know what faithfulness is. When you know, you say somebody's faithful, that means they go to church a lot. They read the Bible regularly. They pray a lot. Or they do the right thing most of the time. That's being faithful. That's what we think of. And however you frame what is faithful, it has to do with you. Am I right? It has to do with your effort and what you're doing. And so the fruit of the Spirit seemed kind of strange to me that it would be, you know, I'm growing your effort in your life. It doesn't make sense. What this is faith. It's not faithfulness, it's faith. It's simply the Greek word pistis, and you can't get faithfulness out of it. We just have adding some letters. So it's faith, it's trust, it's belief. Our translators didn't help us out on this one. So it's belief or trust, and that makes total sense to me. Total sense to me. Does it make sense to you that we need the Holy Spirit to grow our ability to believe, to grow our ability to trust, and to have faith in Him? It's not about trying harder, doing better, and doing more. It's about Him growing belief and trust in our life. Look at our next slide. The Holy Spirit grows these things in our life. We believe and we receive eternal life. John 3:16, for God so loved the world, He gave His one and only Son. And whoever believes in Him shall not perish but will have eternal life. So when we believe, we receive eternal life. But we don't need to stop there. We need to grow in our ability to believe. We need to grow beyond just believing in Jesus for eternal life. Heaven, check. Forgiveness, check. No, we need to learn to trust Him. We need to learn to believe in Him. We need to learn this. Can I just preach just a second? We need to get to where the problems in our life, we believe Him for. The troubles in our life, we understand, we believe that He's bigger than our troubles. He's bigger than our problems. We need to grow belief to believe that He actually cares. That He's concerned about what goes on in our life. When I get to Franklin tonight, I'm preaching on the lost sheep and lost coins. So something in my mind said, well, don't preach that sermon now. You're preaching something else. But, you know, I love the way that there's rejoicing in all of these things at the restoration. We need to believe that God can restore us. I believe that He is able. He's bigger than my disease. He is bigger than my financial woes. He's bigger than my relationship problems. He's bigger than anything going on in my life. I believe that God is able. That's growing belief in our lives. Number three, we got fruit for whiners and Debbie Downers. Do you have anybody, or are you that person that everything always has a little cloud to it? You know, somebody says, well, we beat Auburn by 20 points. Well, we didn't beat them last year. Yeah. Or, you know, you say, you know, well, we had, you know, you brag on something that, you know, you got something down to say about it. Or, you know, well, it took us too long. Or it's not just right. Always something wrong with something. Always a negative spin on stuff. Well, the fruit for whiners and Debbie Downers is patience. Now, this fruit of the Spirit, you know, when you preach a sermon, you ought to have an objective. You ought to be trying to do something. I want to change your mind about how you think about patience. And I know you think good luck with that. But I do. I want to change your mind. Because here's what we think about patience. We think that it is just downright okay for us to not have any patience. People rag on it all the time. Well, I just don't have any patience. Like if having some patience would be a bad thing. We brag on that just like we brag on losing our temper. I lost my temper the other day. Well, can I tell you that wrath and burst of anger? The Bible says all kinds of stuff about that not being good. So if you lose your temper, why don't you just let it stay lost next time? And don't round it back up again for the sake of all of us. Amen? That's what I'm talking about. And on this patience business, you know, I had a friend this week, I was talking to Shane Brodax, and we were talking, he said, you know, it's kind of funny, I said, I don't have any patience, but I can sit in a deer stand, you know, all day. I said, yeah, like 4 or 5 hours. And he said, no, like 10 or 12 hours. Now, I can't do that. First off, you'll freeze to death. deer hunting, I'm trying so hard, but it's just so hard for me. I like duck hunting. And when you deer hunters get saved, you'll start duck hunting. But anyway, when you duck hunt, you can talk, and you can eat, and you can carry on and be stupid. And, you know, and then when the ducks show up, you get quiet. I mean, that's simple as that. You know, you ain't got to just sit around all day, every day, and wait and hope. And, you know, and anyway, so deer hunting. You know, 12, 14 hours, man, 12 hours of what is deer hunting really? It's watching trees and grass grow. That's what it is. It's checking out the bark on a tree. You know, I mean, that's what it is. It's looking at poison ivy. I mean, you know, I mean, we don't have the patience to do the things or to bear up underneath the loads that we have. Or how about, you know, I try to think of some kind of counterpart to deer hunting. And the only thing I could think of was couponing. Do any women have the patience to be couponers? To actually get the newspapers and cut out the deals? I'm not making fun. I'm really not. Yeah. And you know, we're standing like, don't you love to get behind somebody that's got 2 inches of coupons in front of them? You know, and they roll off that well, and then they argue about it. You know, you done got to cut your grocery bill, by 75%. That coupon was for $10, and it's double on Tuesdays. You know, and just, you know. Yeah. No, that coupon still is good. You ever get behind that person? Yes. Well, anyway. You know, and then if your wife is a couponer, not that I know anything about it, you will run out of sugar, soap, coffee, stuff that you have to live. But you will never run out of wash spray, because we have 72 cans of wash spray. I am ready for the invasion of the wash spray. If the wasps ever take on 562 Hollymore Drive, say when. I'm your Huckleberry. I'm ready to rock and roll whenever the wasp invasion comes along, you know. The other day, Jason and them, not his wife coupons, but the other day, not the Sarah coupons, but the other day, Jason ran out of paper towels. They haven't bought paper towel in 4 years, man. You know, just, you know, run out of stuff. Anyway, we have patience in other things. It's just we're selective. We don't have patience in the things that it matters. And then you got the arrogant, smart-aleck response where people say, well, you know, be careful asking God for patience. He's liable to give it to you. And what that means is that the way God gives you patience is by causing you heartache and trouble in your life. Can I tell you that you create enough heartache and trouble for yourself? You know, God's not in heaven trying to figure out ways to torment you, regardless of what you think or what the devil has accused him of. And I'm telling you this, if God wants me to have it, I want it. Because if God wants me to have it, it's got to be the best thing for me. He's got to know more about what I need than I know. Amen? I mean, we're goofus right here. I'm ready to receive what he wants me to have. Look at our next slide. Patience is standing up under the load. My father-in-law, when he taught us to carpenter, he would say, hold what you got. I love that expression. Hold what you got. And think about how it applies spiritually. Hold what you got. In this crazy world, hold what you got. In this wicked and immoral generation, hold what you got. Hang on. Hold what you got. Paul said it like this. When you put on the whole armor of God, you do so you can fight. And the reason you fight is so that you win and still be standing when the fight is over. Stand, he says. Stand, he says, over and over again in that text. That is the objective of your fight. Richie Craig, friend of mine in the Villa Pastor's Harmony Church, really, really great guy. He talks about the armor of God. He says, you know, can you imagine turning it in? When you get to heaven, you're not going to need any armor, are you? You're not going to be in a spiritual battle anymore. Imagine turning your armor in. Well, here's my armor, Lord. And some people turn in their armor and it's going to be all shiny. It's not going to have any dents on it. It's going to look like somebody put a shine on it. It's going to look like you weren't even in a battle. I don't want armor like that, do you? I want armor that's beat up. I want armor that looks like I've been in a scrape somewhere. When I turn in my armor for others to look at it, whoa, man, you got to fight somewhere. To fight Satan, to fight the flesh, we need patience, the ability to stand up underneath the load. Look at our last one. We want to talk today about the rare fruit. I call it the Scooby-Doo fruit. Do we have a train? That is so neat, if y'all just knew my history. We had a church in Bastrop that we started, and right next to it was a train track. Like, and when I say right next to it, I'm talking about like literally 10 feet away. And a train came through every Wednesday night. And every time the train would come through, we would quote the verse from Acts. It says, and the place was shaken in which they fled. But anyway, it's been a long time since I've heard a train blow while I was preaching. When we were in Bastrop, we built a new church. And the new church was like 5 miles away from the train track. And them boys up in Bastrop, they went out and found a train whistle. And I got like 30 seconds into my sermon, and they blew the train whistle in the back of our new building. So, I had to fix this up there. Anyway, the last thing I want to talk about is self-control. And this is, as you can imagine, this is where I want to spend some time. Every alcoholic needs this fruit. Every drug addict, every person who is hooked on prescription meds needs the fruit of self-control in their life. I can tell you right now, if you've got a habit in your life, you don't need to try to quit. You need to quit. And I want to tell you today that the power of God to overcome addiction is there. I want to tell you today that he that is in you is greater than he that is in the world. Amen. That Jesus is stronger than Satan. And that if he wants you to be free, and he does want you to be free, that you don't have to be enslaved by any addiction. You can have the Holy Spirit grow self-control in your life and build fences in your life that you will never cross. That's what you need if you have any kind of problem with any kind of addiction. For those who are involved in any kind of sexual sin, you need self-control in your life. If you're a young person here today or if you're single, I want you to know today that God has called you to celibacy. If that's bad news, I'm sorry, that's it. And if you don't know what that is, that means don't. You're not supposed to have sex, and I know some of you are worried about the children in the room, but if they're 8 and you ain't talked to them, you're late. Can I tell you today that God does not want anybody to have any sexual relationships until they're married? And you need to say no and build self-control, and then when you get married, make up for lost time. Amen? Amen? Amen. That's what I'm talking about. And when you get married, marry somebody of the same gender.
That's right.
No! Would you please find somebody the opposite gender? You know, what kind of world do we live in? How crazy is the world? Self-control. If you feel like you are being tempted to the sin of homosexuality, can I say to you today that you just need to say no to that? I quit having the argument. I have quit having the argument of whether a person is born that way or has taken on that as a lifestyle choice. I'm just going to give that up. I'm going to wave a white flag, okay? I'm going to give up on that. But here's what I want to tell you today. I want to tell you today that if you are that way, you need to stop and you need to repent and stay away from that because it's a sin before God.
Amen.
And if you say, man, that's just backward, can I tell you today that I'm heterosexual, but I have to say no to like 4 billion people on the planet? We all have fences. I love the smell of Budweiser beer. talked the other day, man, that was fine. If you saw me sniffing it, no, I wasn't. And the only, you know, something that smells way better than that is coal. I mean, the best fragrance on planet Earth is coal. Am I right or not? Am I right or not? Huh? I see some of you women are dippers. I can tell by the look you have on your face. It's okay, y'all is too. But you know what, man? You can just take a big whiff of that, man. That's better than honeysuckle, man. But just because I like it, you know, I would like to eat a hamburger. I ain't had one in 7 years. The other day I ate a hot dog. It was the first one in 4 or 5 years. I forgot what they tasted like. It was way overrated in my mind. I'm like, what? God, it tastes like dog food or something. I think that's good. How come I'm not one of those? You know, the whole thing is that, you know, we've got stuff in our life we have to say no to. We don't have no problem. I don't have any problem saying no to Budweiser or Skull. Well, I've got to say no to the things that are hard to say no to. In your sexual life, and then how about this pornography on computers and stuff? Man, that's about self-control. How about these people who want to go around whining all the time, well, I have a problem. As if it's ongoing. And they can't help it. Let me tell you what your problem is. Yeah, you got a problem. You got two problems. You're stupid and you're sinful.
That's right.
And you need to quit your stupid and your sin. That's right. The whole thing is that, you know, this whole thing about these addictions and stuff, you don't need to try to quit. You need to repent. And you need to say no to sin and no to the things that are wrong in your life. Now, everybody's got pent stuff and everybody's got things that they need self-control over. Mine's about eating, man. Man, I'm telling you right now, man, I love to eat. Oh, my goodness. I think about it all the time. I mean, you know, it's like, you know, I'm going to preach a revival in South Louisiana. The only part of my business I ain't taking care of. Where am I going to eat? I ain't hardly got time to eat. Uh-oh. Yeah. I mean, like, you know, when you plan your life around eating, that ain't good. I'll tell you what, man, y'all think I'm playing around here. When you weigh 215 pounds and you're a heart patient and you've already lost about 20 pounds, that ain't good. It's gluttony. Have you ever heard a preacher preach against gluttony? You know how come preachers don't preach on gluttony? Because they're fat. They preach on drinking because they don't drink. And they preach on drugs because they ain't on drugs. And they don't preach, you know, they don't mind preaching on being skanks because they ain't skanks. Boy, they ain't gonna preach on eating too much, because they can scoff down more dumplings than you can shake a stick at. There was a lady got in the grocery line the other day, and she ran into a preacher, literally. And she said to him, "Sir, would you move that beer belly out of my way?" He said, "Ma'am, I'll have you know I'm a Southern Baptist preacher, and I don't ever drink. This is not a beer belly." And she said, "Sir, would you move that chicken coop out of my way?" Now, I'm trying to be kind of humorous here because it's awkward and it's uncomfortable. But the fact is last month from August the 1st to August the 17th, I fasted begging God to grow self-control in my life. And at this point, ever since that fast, every morning when I wake up, I get on my knees. I say, "Lord, I'm tired of being overweight as a heart patient." That's not a sin for you. That's a sin for me. And every night when I go to bed, I pray for self-control. And I'm telling y'all, we need self-control in our life. I don't know what it is you struggle with or what it is that works you over, beats you up. The self-control, the Holy Spirit, will grow self-control in your life. Now, here's what I want to tell you as we close this up. I'm not asking you to look at our next slide. I'm not telling you today that, you know, you need to try harder. You need to work harder. I'm not telling you to do more or to do better. I'm asking you to seek God and to ask His Holy Spirit to grow fruit in your life. Like Jacob wrestled with the angel. Listen to Jeremiah 29. You will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. Look at our last slide today. Receive His free gift of eternal life. Say no to the works of the flesh. Mortify the works of the flesh. And ask the Holy Spirit to grow His fruit in your life. We're going to have a time of invitation. If you're here today and you'd like to be saved, I want to invite you to come. We had a guy saved at the last service. His wife joined the church. Maybe you're here today and you'd like to become a part of our church family. We'd love to have you. We invite you to come. Maybe you're here today and you will come to the altar and repent. These set of chairs, that's our altar today. We've had people out in here today. If you want to come and pray, we invite you to come. If you want to pray and ask God to help you to overcome the works of the flesh and ask Him to grow the fruits of the Holy Spirit in your life, we invite you to come.